I'm Abdul Khader from KPT Mangalore, once again welcoming you to our next online interactive class on professional ethics and Indian Constitution. So far, we have completed 5 units. First, we completed the unit 1, which was on human values. The second unit was on engineering ethics. The third unit was on safety responsibilities of engineers. And the fourth unit was on the ethical issues in engineering practice. And the fifth unit, which we completed in our last class, was on human rights. These were the units which were dealing with the professional ethics parts of our curriculum. Now, in this class, we'll start unit 6. This unit 6 is on Indian Constitution. We have completed our previous units in either 2 or 3 classes, but this unit is a comparatively longer unit. So we'll be completing this unit in 6 classes. Let us now discuss the specific content which we'll be discussing today. Initially, we'll discuss the need for a constitution. That is, why do we actually need a constitution for governing a nation? Then we'll be discussing the Constituent Assembly and the role of Constituent Assembly in drafting and framing the constitution. Then we'll be discussing the basic functions of the constitution. We'll then move on to discuss the preamble to our constitution, which begins with the word "We the people of India," and it has got very important the words which have got in-depth meaning. We'll be discussing the meaning of those terms. We'll be discussing about what is sovereignty, what is socialism, what is secularism, what is democracy, what is liberty, what is fraternity, justice, equality, justice, fraternity, dignity, dignity of the individual, and unity and integrity of the nation. We'll be discussing these important terms today. Then we'll want to discuss the salient features of our constitution. How is our constitution unique? We'll be discussing those aspects. And finally, as usual, we'll have an interactive quiz where you can actively participate. In olden days, the countries were traditionally ruled by kings and sometimes by queens. In that setup, king was the representative of God. It means whatever he does is through the will of God, and he can do almost anything within his powers. There was no scope for any regulatory mechanism. So strictly speaking, kings do not need guidelines for ruling because God has given them the authority to rule and consequently the right to make rules and laws as per their sweet will and wish. Of course, the kings have adopted regulatory mechanism on their own, but that is the exception, not the rule. With the advent of democracy, it was ruled by the people. The country was governed by the elected representatives of the people. In such a scenario, there was a need for clear guidelines regarding how the elected representatives should govern the country. Such a document is the Constitution. Obviously, this is the most important document as far as country is concerned. The country is governed as per the Constitution. Should all of us be familiar with the Constitution? Whether we understand it or not, we are bound by it. So it is better we understand the Constitution and live as enlightened citizens. So the Constitution is a document containing the rules and regulations for governing a nation. That is, it is a document which contains the rules and regulations about how a nation is to be governed. So this document forms the bond between the people and the government. The rights and obligations of the people and the government are clearly specified. The government is not permitted to do anything that is unconstitutional. The Constitution provides mechanisms to protect itself. Now, let us come to the basic functions of the Constitution. First and foremost, the Constitution provides a basic structure of our political system. This political system includes the president as head of the state, the prime minister, council of ministers, and an entire executive body in place. We have parliament and the legislature to pass laws, an executive to implement, and a judiciary to interpret the laws. This entire system is provided by the Constitution. It reflects the aspirations of the people, janara ashottaragalu. So this aspiration of the people is reflected in the Constitution. As is rightly said by Abraham Lincoln, democracy ensures a government of the people, by the people, for the people. The governance is to fulfill the aspirations of the people. It reflects the vision of the founding fathers of our nation. We had great minds led by Mahatma Gandhi for fighting for freedom. They did not the fight for freedom to just to change the color of the rulers. So there is no point in the changing from the slavery of the white-skinned people to the slavery of the brown-skinned people. That is, there is no benefit in just changing the rulers. So there is some fundamental reasons, and there is a vision behind in changing the rulers, that is the fighting for political freedom. This, the vision of the founding fathers, is reflected in the Constitution. The Constitution provides a link between the people and the government. That is what the government can expect from the people and what people can expect from the government. This is as per the Constitution. So it is the binding block, binding link between the people and the government. And it also gives the guidance to the government about how to govern the nation. That is how a state is to be run, how a government is to be run. This basic guideline for running the nation is given by the Constitution. These are the basic functions which any constitution need to fulfill. Let's come to the Constituent Assembly. The Constitution was framed by an august body which consisted of prominent people of India at the time of independence. This body was the Constituent Assembly, which was formed with the objective of framing the Constitution. Congress was in fact the only party of significance in the country at that time. So majority of the members were from the Congress party. But at the same time, they have taken special care to include people holding all shares of opinion, right, left, center. The proper representation was given to all sections of society. So Constituent Assembly was truly representative of the people of India. We'll look into it in a little more detail. The Constituent Assembly is a body or assembly of representatives constituted for the purpose of drafting or adopting a constitution. The Constituent Assembly is usually set up for the specific purpose, which carries out in a relatively short time the duty of framing the constitution. And after that, the assembly is dissolved. The Constituent Assembly is a form of representative democracy. That is, the Constituent Assembly is formed with the task of framing the constitution, and it consists of a set of eminent people who are popularly elected. So that is, our Constituent Assembly consisted of the eminent people who are the popularly elected members with the specific task of framing the constitution. This group of people elected for framing the constitution together is called the Constituent, the Assembly. Now let's look into the important aspects of the Indian Constituent Assembly. The Constituent Assembly for framing our constitution was elected to write the Constitution of India, and it also served as temporary parliament because the elections were to be done later based on the constitution. So these members, this Constituent Assembly was formed based on the negotiation between the leaders of our freedom movement and the British cabinet mission. So this Constituent Assembly was formed based on the negotiation on the Indian side by the Indian, the independence movement leaders, and from the British side by the British, the cabinet mission. The Constituent Assembly was elected indirectly from the members of the Provisional Legislative Assembly, which was present at that time. So even in the British Raj, there was the provisional, the assemblies present, and from these, the assemblies, the members of the Constituent Assembly were selected. Originally, it was a Constituent Assembly for the whole of India. It consists of the 389 members. Later, a separate Constituent Assembly was formed for the Pakistan due to partition. And finally, the members of the Indian Constituent Assembly came down to 299. As we know, we got our independence on August 15, 1947, and this Constituent Assembly met for the first time on December 9, 1946 in Delhi. That was the first meeting of the Constituent Assembly. Then, at the time of the meeting, we needed a chairman. So Dr. Sachidananda Sinha was the first chairman of the Constituent Assembly. Of course, not an elected chairman. He was the temporary chairman for the Constituent Assembly. Later, Constituent Assembly elected Dr. Rajendra Prasad as the first elected president of the Constituent Assembly. Then Dr. Ambedkar drafted the Constitution of India in conjunction with the requisite deliberations and debates in the Constituent, the Assembly. So that is, Dr. Ambedkar was instrumental in drafting the Constitution with the requisite deliberations and debates which has taken place in the Constituent Assembly. The Assembly approved the Constitution on November 26, 1949, that is the 2 months before January 26, 1950. That is, the Constituent Assembly, they adopted the Constitution on November 26, which was exactly 2 months before our Republic was founded, before the Republic Day, that is the day on which the Constitution came into existence. That was January 26, 1950, which we are celebrating as Republic Day every year. Once the Constitution took effect, the Constituent Assembly became the provisional, the Parliament of India. So temporary, the India was in need of the Parliament. So until the first elections were held in 1952, that is up to 1952, this Constituent Assembly also worked as the Provisional Parliament of India. Once the first election took place in 1952, there were the elected members, they constituted the Parliament. The Assembly, as we have seen, met for the first time in Delhi on 9 December 1946. And for the last time, that is the last session of the Constituent Assembly, was held on 24 January 1950. That was the last day of the session of the Constituent Assembly. And between this first day and the last day, in this period, there was a time gap of 2 years, 11 months, and 18 days. And during these days, during this period, it held not less than 11 sessions and a total of 166 and a total of 166 days. Then let's come to the step of framing the Constitution. The first, the Constituent Assembly formed the various committees, because the Constitution is a huge affair. So all the subcommittees were formed, entrusted with looking into specific aspects of the Constitution, and these committees were formed. And these committees deliberated about the Constitution within the subcommittees, and these subcommittees submitted the recommendation to the main committee, where the B.N. Rao was the member of the advisory branch of the Assembly. He compiled the different reports, and based on this compilation, a drafting committee was formed with Dr. B.R. Ambedkar as the chairman of the drafting committee. And under the leadership of the drafting committee, it prepared a draft of the Constitution and submitted this draft to the Constituent Assembly on 21 February 1948. That is, the drafting committee headed by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar submitted the draft of the Constitution on this date, 21st February 1948. Now, this draft Constitution was published, and suggestions, recommendations, comments, and criticism was invited from all the concerned people. That is, the wide publicity was given to this proposal, to this the draft Constitution, so that it can be modified, it can be changed based on the people's ideas and suggestions to get the best possible Constitution. So the suggestions, the comments and criticisms were invited with respect to the draft Constitution. Now, the members of the drafting committee finalized the draft based on the suggestions, comments and criticisms received. And finally, the draft was discussed in the Constituent Assembly, the clause by clause. Each and every word, every word of the Constitution was discussed in the Constituent Assembly. It did not pass anything in a haste. That means the utmost care was taken in drafting, in the passing the Constitution. And finally, on this date, 26th November 1949, exactly 2 months before it came into effect, the Constitution was passed in the Constituent Assembly. And all the members signed the constitution on 25th January 1950, just one day before it came into effect. That is, on 25th January, the members of the Constituent Assembly signed the constitution. That was on the last day. And from next day onwards, from the January 26, 1950 onwards, the constitution came into existence. This is about a brief, the outline of the process followed in framing the constitution. Let's come to the preamble to the constitution. The preamble is the introductory part of the constitution. Let's look more into the preamble. The preamble is an introductory part to the constitution, and it explains the underlying philosophy behind the constitution. So that means it explains the philosophy which was formed, or it's the basic structure of the constitution is specified in this preamble. You might be thinking that because it comes in the beginning, it might have been written in the beginning. No, even if it comes in the beginning, it was written, it was included after the entire constitution was finished. It was the end, because if you want to get an overall idea of the entire content of the constitution and put it in the preamble, you will have to have an overall idea of the entire constitution. That means after the entire constitution was framed, the preamble was written and it was included in the first part, as the first part of the constitution. And this preamble, as I already said, it gives the underlying philosophy of the constitution, but it does not include the legally binding, the parts of constitution with articles. This gives an overall idea about the constitution. That is the preamble. It explains the other part of the constitution. It helps to interpret the other parts of the constitution. Let's come to the preamble. Preamble tells, "We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to ensure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political liberty of thought, expression, and belief, equality of status and opportunity, and to promote among all of them fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation." And it ends like this: "In our constituent assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact, and give ourselves this constitution." So this is the important part of the preamble to the constitution. Here it starts with the word, "We, the people of India." That means nobody has given us this constitution. We have given us this constitution ourselves. That is, the constitution gets its authority from the people of India, and these are all the things the constituents guarantees. These are things the constitution promises to the people of the India. And again, it says, in our constituent assembly, we have enacted this. We are adopted and enacted to give ourselves this constitution. That means we are giving this constitution to ourselves. That is about the preamble to the constitution. Now, let's look into the aspects or the key issues which the preamble discusses. As I said, it starts with "We, the people of India." See, it means it gets the constitution, gets its authority from the people. That means it is not United Nations, it is not any other body, it is not the kings or queens. It is the people who have given the constitution. The constitution derives its authority from the people. And it also means that when we say with we, the people of India, this we represents representatives of all sections of the people were involved in making this constitution. This we includes all the sections of the society which was directly or indirectly involved in preparing and framing this constitution. Let's come to the next important word, sovereignty. That means we are a sovereign nation. The sovereignty means the complete independence. So we enjoy absolute independence as a nation. When I say absolute independence, no other country has a right to interfere in the internal or external policies of the state. We are an independent nation. We make the rules and policies for ourselves. No other nation has a right to interfere in our internal external policies. That's about sovereignty. The next word is the socialism. Socialism is a word. What does it mean is that the government controls the production and distribution of goods either wholly or the partly. That means the production and distribution of the goods are wholly or partly controlled by the government. It means the industrial activities is controlled by government, financial services, the educational institutions, health, and other institutions are run by the government. Of course, over the year, it has become less and less socialistic and more capitalistic with the liberalization. But still, you can see that the government runs education institutions, government runs health services, the financial services, even the certain industries. Many of the resources are still with the government. That is what secularism, the socialism envisages. The aim of this socialism is to reduce the gap between the rich and poor. The money is also like water. If you look at water, it flows from mountain to the sea. But there is scarcity of water in the mountain. There's a plenty of water in the sea. But still, water flows from mountain to sea only. Money is also like that. Money is does not flow from poor rich people to poor people. It always flows from poor people to rich people. Rich people become more and more rich. Poor people are getting more and more poor. So this creates an inequality of the wealth in the society. This makes a big the gap between the rich and poor. To reduce this gap is the aim of socialism. Originally, it was like this. The rich had money, poor had weapons. Now things have become capitalism. Now the both money as well as weapon is with the rich people. There is need for reversal of this inequality of wealth in the society. Next important word is secularism. What is secularism? Secularism does not mean that we are going against God or the lack of belief in God. That means as an individual, human beings are free to follow any religion, believe in any God. But the secularism means the state or the government does not have any religion. That means the government, the activities, government function, government rules, government, the policies, procedures should not favor or should not work against any religion. That means the government does not make discrimination between the religions. The government is absolutely neutral as per secularism. Government does not favor any religion. Government does not disfavor any religion. Government does not take religion into consideration in its the activities. It takes the social aspects, not the religious aspects, when it is making rules and policies. This is a very important cornerstone of the Constitution for maintaining social harmony. In brief, Secularism means government does not have any religion. Government is free of religion. Individuals can follow whatever religions they want. In short, the secularism ensures the equal status for all religions, equal honor, equal dignity, and equal rights to every person, irrespective of his religion or faith. That is secularism. Let's come to the next word in the preamble, that is the democracy. There is a famous the word of Abraham Lincoln. He says, democracy is for the people, by the people, of the people. That summarizes what is democracy. This democracy is based on the universal adult, the franchise. That is the sarvatrika vayaska matadana. The person above the age of 18 years can vote. He can elect the members. These elected members form the legislature and they become mayors and the rulers. They rule the nation. That means basically it is the universal adult franchise where people vote to elect the people who they prefer to govern. That is the democracy. That means indirectly we are being governed by the people we elect. But we need to remember that the political democracy is not the end of democracy. As I was mentioning, when the British were there, we were ruled by white skinned people. Now, after we got independence, we are ruled by our own people, the brown skinned people. Now, if we were before independence, if we are the slaves of the white skinned people, and after independence, if we become slaves of the brown skinned people, there is no point in the democracy. So the political democracy is not the end in itself. This democracy, what we got after independence, this should lead to social democracy. That is, the political is not the end. Every person should be part of the society. He should be able to dignity and justice. Every person should be able to live in dignity and justice with welfare in the society. That is social democracy. Similarly, it should lead to economic democracy. That means every person should have the equal economic opportunities and rights. That is, the social democracy and economic democracy should be obtained because of the political democracy. So that is about the democracy. Coming to the next word is the liberty. We are all born free and we have an inherent right to live free. That is our constitution, the guarantees the freedom, all sorts of freedom, freedom of thought, freedom of expression, freedom of belief. These are all the freedoms promised by the constitution, and all these freedoms are included in the fundamental rights. We'll be discussing the fundamental rights in great detail in our next class. Every person has got a liberty, has got a freedom to live in any part of India. That is, the freedom of movement is assured by the constitution. Every person has got the liberty to earn his livelihood by legal means. Nobody can prevent a person from earning his livelihood legally. These are the liberty rights with the constitution guarantees right in the preamble. Next is equality. The equality is another the important thing which the constitution assures to every citizen right in the preamble. That is the equality before law. Before law, we are all equal, either President Shri Ramnath Kovind or the Prime Minister Narendra Modi or our Chief Minister or ourselves. Each one is equal before law. The law is to be equally applied to every person, irrespective of any consideration, the status, the religion, faith, economic conditions. So none of them prevents a person from claiming his equality, that is equality before law. And there cannot be any discrimination which is against equality. So there cannot be the discrimination based on caste, cannot be discrimination based on creed, no discrimination based on religion, no discrimination based on economic status or the social, the status or language or gender. So none of the parameters, including these things, can be a basis for discrimination. So discrimination is the against the our constitution. Next word is justice. Justice has got various dimensions. One is the political justice. The political justice means everybody is free to vote. Not only free to vote, everybody is free to contest in an election. That is a political right of every person. That is a political justice. Similarly, economic justice means the every person has got an economic right. This right involves narrowing down the gap between the rich and poor. Everybody is entitled to basic the needs. That is what the Constitution guarantees. Similarly, social justice. Everybody has got a right against social discrimination. That is, discrimination on the basis of caste is or any other consideration is illegal and punishable as per the Constitution. Next, by doing all those things, what is that we want to achieve by justice? By providing justice to everybody, what is that we want to achieve is that the Constitution envisages development of fraternity, which means brotherhood among all the citizens of the country. That is, everybody should feel a sense of brotherhood, a sense of belonging with the other person, and that leads to a very harmonious society. That is the ultimate aim of the Constitution. While doing all these things, the Constitution takes two important things into consideration. One is the dignity of the individual is always respected. That means everybody has got a right to live in dignity. That means he should have an adequate means of livelihood. He should have a condition for work. He should have a decent standard of free life, which is free from all sorts of the exploitations, which promotes and maintains his dignity as a human being. That means everything should be done taking the dignity of the individual into consideration. Another thing which it has to be taken into consideration is the unity and integrity of the nation. That means the entire nation is one and whole, undivided. We cannot have the divisional tendencies to break up the nation. That is, the integrity of the nation is a prime consideration in the preamble, which emphasizes the unity and integrity of the nation. And it means that all of us should stay united to protect this unity and integrity of the country, both in times of external attack or in terms of internal disturbances. In such situations, it is a duty of everybody to hold on to unity and integrity of the nation. So that was about the important terms which were discussed in the Constitution, in the preamble of the Constitution. Now let's come to the salient features of our Constitution. Our Constitution is the longest written constitution in the world. Many countries have constitution, we have a written constitution, but it is interesting to note that Britain has a constitution which is unwritten. They don't have a constitution, a compiled written constitution like us today. But it does not mean that their democracy is not functioning. British democracy is one of the best functional democracies in the world today, but still that operates on the unwritten, the constitution. And it's the longest written constitution is ours. Then the question comes, who has got the shortest constitution? It's the USA, the America, which has got the shortest the constitution in the world. Next, the question comes, if it is long, how long is our constitution? Our constitution was written at the time of the writing constitution. It had 395 articles in 22 parts under 8 schedules. And later, over the years, the amendments were incorporated in the constitution. And right now, in 2017, the constitution has got 448 articles. It has got 25 parts under 12 schedules. And there are a number of amendments have taken place. The last one was 101st Amendment. This amendment was done to introduce the famous the GST, Goods and Services, the Tax Act. The second important feature of our constitution is that our constitution is something like a khichdi. We have drawn from different sources. That is, the constitution, drawn from different sources, then is it bad or good? It is not bad because we have taken the best from different constitutions and incorporate in our constitution. For example, we have taken the parliamentary democracy from the British constitution. So that means the British constitution is the basis for the parliamentary democracy in our constitution. Similarly, the fundamental rights were taken from the United States of America, from USA. So that is, the fundamental rights part was adopted from the British, from the US constitution. Similarly, the emergency powers, that is the declaration of the emergency, those things were adopted by the German, the constitution. And our constitution also contains what are known as directive principles. So these directive principles were taken from the Irish constitution. That is, we have taken the best from different constitutions. Another important feature of our constitution is that our constitution is partly flexible and partly rigid. Rigid means something which we cannot change, which is very firm, which we cannot change. The flexible is something which is adaptable change, which can be modified very easily. Our constitution is flexible as well as rigid. That is, if you ask me whether the constitution cannot be changed, answer is yes, constitution can be changed. That is, constitution is flexible. It is amenable for changes and amendments. But at the same time, there are certain conditions. The basic structure of the constitution cannot be changed. That is, any changes should be done in such a way that the basic structure does not change. The important words which we discussed in preamble, they are parts of the basic structure of the constitution, and changing them will change the very constitution itself. So the basic structures cannot be changed. So that makes it rigid. And also, then the elaborate process for changing the constitution, it is not easy. It is not like passing any law. For changing constitution, there is an elaborate procedure where both in Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha, it has to be passed by more than 2/3 majority, and for even a quorum, more than half the members should be present, unlike other acts where only 10% is the quorum. And for some of the amendments, not only Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, even not less than half of the state assemblies must also approve the change. So there is elaborate procedure for changing the constitution, which makes it rigid. So it can be changed, but changing is not an easy process. Next is, it is federal in form and unitary in spirit. America is a truly federal country where the states have their own constitution and are completely autonomous, except in some subjects like defense, communication, foreign affairs, etc., which should remain uniform across the whole country. India is not a completely federal country. In fact, USA is formed based on agreement between different states, but ours is union of the states. So that means in India, the center holds the more powers compared to the state, but at the same time, state also have got their powers. So that is, in a federal system, it means that there is power decentralization between the state and the central governments. That is, the powers are distributed between the central and state. That makes it the federal. At the same time, it makes it unitary because union government, that is a central government, retains the overall control in spite of the decentralization. That is, then overall control still exists with the central government. For example, the Article 356, which says that the central government, the president, can dissolve the state, the assemblies, if there is a constitutional breakdown in the state. I mean, of course, what Dr. Ambedkar said was that he wants this Article 356 to be a dead letter, never to be used. But it was used more than 100 times to dissolve the states. But now, after the Supreme Court has given a judgment on the SR Bommai versus the Union Government case, it has laid down elaborate procedure for the central to dissolve the states. Now, the misuse of the Article 356 has come down. This Article 56 is against the federal, the form of government. Well, what I was mentioning is that the Indian constitution is both federal and unitary. There is the distribution of power. At the same time, center has got the overall control of the entire nation. Next is parliamentary system with elected president as the head. A parliamentary system of government means that the executive branch of the government has the direct or indirect support of the parliament. This support is usually by a vote of confidence. In a parliamentary system, the person enjoying the confidence of the parliament becomes the prime minister. On the other hand, there is a presidential system where president is directly elected by the people and is not the answerable to the government. Next, the government, that is ministers and executives, get their authority from the elected bodies, that is parliament and state assemblies. That's what the parliamentary system means. Here, even the president of the nation is elected by the indirect election. That will be discussed in later chapters. Next is universal adult franchise. Universal adult franchise means anybody above the age of 18 years has got a right to vote. That means everybody who is above age of 18 years has got a say in selecting the MPs and MLAs and other elected representatives. Similarly, anybody above the age of 25 years can contest for MP or MLA, and anybody over the age of 30 years can contest for Rajya Sabha MP or MLC of Vidhana Parishad. That is the universal adult franchise. Next is the single citizenship. Many countries allow dual citizenship. For example, dual citizenship which is also known as dual nationality, is allowed in UK. This means you can be a British citizen and also a citizen of other countries. You can apply for free for foreign citizenship and keep a British citizenship. Much of the developed countries such as US, Australia, Switzerland, they have got no restrictions on holding dual nationality. But our constitution recognizes only single citizenship. That is, the anybody who is within the geographical boundary in India can have citizenship, and he cannot have citizenship of any other country at the same time. That means if he gets the citizenship of any other country, automatically he has to forfeit the citizenship of India. Simultaneously, he cannot have the citizenship of India as well as another country. That's what the single citizenship means. Next is independence of judiciary. Indian judiciary is a single unified judicial system which is independent. That is, the separation of power is a fundamental guarantee of independence of the judiciary. The decision-making process should involve in such a way that judges should have freedom to decide cases impartially in accordance with the interpretation of the law and the facts. They shouldn't be able to act without any restriction or improper influence. So this applies to right from Supreme Court to all the subordinate courts. Next is the Charter of Fundamental Rights. Our Constitution in Part 3 guarantees the fundamental rights to the citizens. These fundamental rights are inviolable rights guaranteed to every citizen of India by the Constitution. That is, any law or any executive action cannot take away these rights. This fundamental right is the soul of the Constitution. We'll be discussing the exclusively on fundamental rights in our the next class. Next, we'll come to the directive principles. Directive principles of state policy aim to create a social and economic conditions under which citizen can lead a good life. The aim of directive principles is to establish a social and economic democracy and make India into a welfare state. That is, the directive principles are nothing but certain ideals which the framers of the Constitution thought of the Indian state must try to achieve for national well-being. So these are the principles which direct the government in making its policies and making its decisions. And finally, the duties. The fundamental duties were originally not part of the Constitution. These were included in the 42nd Amendment to the Constitution. So that is, the Constitution was amended in 1976. That was the 42nd Amendment, and certain obligations of the citizens with respect to the nation were included in the Constitution. We'll be discussing this, the fundamental duties also in our next class. Well, friends, we started our discussion today with a discussion on the need for a constitution. We discussed the basic functions of the Constitution, and then we went on to discuss the Constituent Assembly and its role in framing the Constitution. Preamble is a very important part of the Constitution. Even though it comes in the beginning, it was carefully included after the entire Constitution was formed. It contains very important the principles with respect to the basic structure of a Constitution. We discussed those words in detail. This the preamble specifies the underlying philosophy of our constitution. The certain important words which we discussed was with respect to sovereignty, democracy, socialism, secularism, liberty, justice, fraternity, etc. Towards the end of our class, we discussed the salient features of our constitution. Our constitution is unique in the world. It is one of the best constitution. If at all problems are there, it is not with respect to the constitution. It is with respect to the implementation of the constitution. We have one of the best possible constitution, and it is our duty to protect the constitution. In fact, one of the greatest achievement of us of the post-independent India is that we have so far able to protect the constitution. Well, that was about the today's class. Now we'll want to discuss. We'll want to play an interactive quiz based on today's class. Thank you.